6:37. If you're looking for a wild way to celebrate next Monday's total solar eclipse, then look no further than the Seneca Park Zoo.
Yeah, throughout the weekend, they will have eclipse-themed events, and Chris Lopez is there this morning giving us a preview of what people can expect. Chris, what's going on?
Hey, guys. Yeah, good morning. Here, headquarters, Seneca Park Zoo. I'm with Steve Lacey. He's the director here. They have a big weekend. You guys have a big weekend going on leading up to a once-in-a-lifetime event. 3 days, I believe. What do you guys have going on for those 3 days?
That's right. We're really very excited about having people come out and join us here at the zoo. We've got a lot of great activities planned. We're bringing in a couple of very renowned experts, an astrophysicist and a heliophysicist. We can talk a little bit more about that in a minute. We've also got some activities throughout the zoo to help our guests understand what's going on in the sky, how they can safely view the eclipse, and what's going on in the sky with the moon and the sun that's creating this amazing phenomenon.
And when it comes to planning for this, we've known about the eclipse now for a while. Eclipse, eclipse, eclipse. It's all people can talk about. When did you guys start planning for this event?
This has been an event that we've been working on for well over a year. Wow. With some of our teams. We wanted to make sure that we had the eclipse viewing glasses. We knew that they were going to be in high demand, so we wanted to make sure we had a bunch of those. And we wanted to make sure we had a great program lined up for all of our guests to come and see.
and in terms of this, who is this geared towards? Is this just your nerds that are looking for the how this affects animals, or is this families, kids?
You know, we've got a little bit of something for everyone. Obviously, Seneca Park Zoo is a great place for families, and we always welcome our families. But we also want to bring in a little bit of science so that the parents and some of the older kids would have something to do during the eclipse as well.
And where can someone grab tickets or find out more about this event?
Oh, that's a great point. If you go to senecaparkzoo.org/eclipse, you can find out where we've got our pre-ticket sales going on and all the information of the programs going on here at the zoo for the eclipse.
Beautiful. I love it. Come check it out, Seneca Park Zoo, going down all weekend leading up to the eclipse and on Eclipse Day. They got a lot of fun educational stuff going on here. Dan, Abby, back to you in studio.
That thing is terrifying. Look
I
at
know,
that.
It's so cool at the same
it
time.
Is.
Cool from over here on this side of the camera.
Yes, it's a lot nicer to just look at it.
Chris, thank you very much. We'll check back in with you in just a little bit. And a reminder, we have everything you need to know about the eclipse, including all of the events happening before, during, and after April 8th online at 13wham.com. And our live eclipse coverage begins next Monday at 2 o'clock on 13wham ABC. But the upcoming total solar eclipse won't just be experienced by us humans.
No, it won't. Animals of all kinds, including those at the Seneca Park Zoo, will all witness the totality, experiencing it just like we will. 13WAM's Chris Lopez is live there at the zoo for us this morning with more. Hey, Chris, how's it going?
Not too bad, Dan. Good morning. So not only are humans going to have some type of effect, or plants, animals, just like the gray wolf, you may be able to see them. They are trancing around somewhere around here. There we go. They're also going to be affected by the path of totality from its switching from day to light. I'm here with David Hamilton, his curator here at the Seneca Park Zoo. And so how is that? How are animals going to be reacting when this phenomenon starts to happen?
Good morning. It'll maybe look a bit confusing to them. It'll slowly be getting darker. They might just think a cloud's coming across the sky. And then as it gets darker and darker, then they might start thinking that it's getting time for night.
And when that happens, what kind of, like, I know it's going to be very specific to the animal, but what kinds of animals may have some different types of reactions that people can look forward to?
It's their animals that are nocturnal, those that are active at night. As it starts getting night time, appears to be getting night, then they're going to start getting ready for bed, maybe. Or if they're nocturnal animals, start waking up and start moving around more. We may get some vocalizations from the different animals as it starts getting dark.
And we were kind of talking about who would have the most reaction, and the baboons, you said, were going to have. And why is that?
I think the baboons are going to be the most observant as to what's going on around them. They're going to be We're going to have a lot of people here, so they're going to be watching the people a lot. And then as it starts getting dark, then they may start headed back towards their night quarters because they think it's time for dinner. Or they may just be wondering what's going on out here.
Will they be disoriented? Because, you know, I would, if my alarm clock turned on and then it turned off, I'd be like, what the heck is going on? That's pretty much what's going on with them, their alarm clock turning off and turning on. Will they be a little disoriented when this happens?
I think they might be a little bit confused about why that was such a short night once it's all over. But everything will be pretty much normal within a few minutes after the eclipse.
Awesome. Look at that gray wolf, guys. He's headed back, trying to hide, a little bit camera shy right now. But these are lovely animals. There's also a snow leopard, but oh, there she is right there. I believe that is a female.
Tamila. This is Tamila. There's their female snow leopard. We have Kaba and Tamila. So they might be one of the ones that are active as well. So we hope people come out to the zoo to see what the animals are doing. Anybody that's interested in science or interested in animals should come to the zoo on Monday.
You heard it from David. She is beautiful. Check that out, guys. Back to you in studio.
Really, that is beautiful. Gorgeous.
My gosh.
I know. Look at that tail.
Yeah.
That's incredible, Chris. Stay
Thank
away.
You very...
Stay far away, my friend.
A reminder, we have everything you need to know about the eclipse on our website, 13wham.com. That includes all of the events happening before, during, and after April 8th. That's under the total solar eclipse section of our website. Don't forget, the live eclipse coverage begins next Monday at 2 o'clock on 13 Wham ABC. That is for the special. Of course, we will have much more all morning long on Monday, the day of the eclipse. The total solar eclipse is almost here, and the Seneca Park Zoo is educating people of all ages about this once-in-a-lifetime event.
They sure are, and this weekend they are offering family-friendly activities that are sure to get everyone excited about April 8th. Monday, the big day. Chris Lopez is there getting a preview of everything people can expect. Chris, how's it going?
Not too bad, Dan. Here, headquarters Seneca Park Zoo. I'm with Steve Lacey, the director here. Now, there's been research about animals reacting to total solar eclipses dating back centuries. I was reading before this that there was an Italian monk back in 1239 that wrote in his journal that when the total solar eclipse happened, that his animals were acting pretty much, in other words, crazy. So you guys are gonna be having a lot going on that looks into how animals are reacting. You guys have a 3-day weekend going on. It starts Saturday, goes through into Monday. What's going on?
Right. We have got so many great activities going on for all of our guests to come when they come to the zoo. In fact, we've got two great scientists that are going to be here, and we picked these scientists to help our guests as they're watching the eclipse. The first one, her name is Emily Rice, and she is actually very special to us because she was in our zoo team program many years ago where it helped to foster her love of science. She graduated on and is now an astrophysicist and is coming back to Seneca Park Zoo to help all of our guests learn how to safely view the eclipse. So she's going to help us learn how to make pinhole cameras and teach our guests everything they need to do to make sure that they can experience the eclipse, but do it safely. The second scientist we have coming, his name is Skyler Kleinschmidt, and he is part of the Science Mission Directorate Heliophysicist Division of NASA. That's a mouthful of words, and what it means is Skyler studies the sun and how the sun impacts the solar system and all of our planets. And he's going to be here to tell us about some of the research projects that NASA is conducting while the eclipse is going on. It's going to be fascinating, fascinating.
And so you have these big guests coming through, a ton of knowledge. Where can people find them? Are they going to be roaming around? Are they going to have presentations going on? How can people find out about these people?
Yeah, absolutely. So we actually are going to have some stations for both of our guests. So if people want to, for both of our scientists, I should say, so when guests come in, they can come up and interact with them face to face. We also have some scheduled talks for Skyler to come out and present all of the information that NASA has going on about the eclipse. So there'll be lots of opportunities for our guests to interact with these guys as they travel through the zoo.
And you spoke about a teen, what was that word?
Yes, one of our zoo team program. It's a very special program we've got for young people that are interested in science and want to foster their knowledge of science so they can come to the zoo and become kind of volunteers and ambassadors for the zoo to the public. And of course, Emily Rice was one of those, and she was very successful, so we're really excited about having her come back.
And are they going to be here throughout the weekend, or are they just going to be here on Eclipse Day?
Yes, they will be here through the weekend. We've got Skylar here for 2 days. We have much of our other programming will be going through the full weekend, which includes some naturalist stuff. We have some folks that will be talking about that later, but literally hands-on activities for our guests to come and take a look at some of the natural things that we've got all around our environment in our area, including the lake down here right next to the zoo.
And so right now, I gotta mention the sea lions.
Yes.
And we were talking about them. Look at that going through right there. How do you feel that these guys are gonna react when it comes to that day?
Right, so these are California sea lions. And you know, one of the amazing things about this eclipse is it's a once in a lifetime thing. We can guess, we think that these guys are gonna go into nighttime mode, but really, Chris, we don't know. We're not 100% sure. So we're very eager to watch and to learn and observe what the animals are gonna do. We're not really 100% sure.
Let me see if one's gonna come up. Before this hit, one was staring at me. He looks like he's mean mugging. Come on, guys, make some good television. And there we go. Flying past with his flippers. And they can walk on all fours. That's the difference between the otters and the sea lions. Is that correct?
Between a seal and a sea lion, that's right. California sea lions are able to walk on all four of their flippers. You'll notice in the habitat there's lots of rocks. Being able to walk up on all four flippers allows them to climb up on these rocks just like they would out in the Pacific Ocean.
Beautiful. And how can people find out more about attending your 3-day extravaganza?
Oh, absolutely. Yes. You can go to SenecaParkZoo.org/eclipse. And there's all kinds of information about early ticket sales, about some of the programming we've got. It's a place you want to be to make sure that you are into the zoo on Monday afternoon.
I love it. Come hang out here, Seneca Park Zoo. A ton of stuff going on around the valley. If you're an animal lover, this is the spot to be. Dan, Abby, back to you guys in studio. Look at these guys, the grace.
This guy needs another cup of coffee.
Yeah, just resting there on the rocks. Chris, question for you. What is a seal's, or a sea lion's, rather, favorite subject in school?
I'm sorry, repeat that? I think that was a joke.
Yes, what's a sea lion's favorite subject in school?
I don't know.
Art?
Optometry? Nice.
Lame.
The dad jokes. I love it, Dan.
It was, but it was good.
Whatever.
A good joke.
Chris Lopez,
good
thanks
dad joke.
So much. We'll check back in with you in just a little bit.
All right. Thank you very much, John. The total solar eclipse is now just 4 days away, and the Seneca Park Zoo is hosting a weekend of eclipse-themed events.
The lineup will be both fun and educational, teaching guests about how the eclipse will affect animals. Chris Lopez has been live there all morning, learning a thing or two about it himself. Hey, Chris, where are you right now?
Good morning, guys. Here at the Lions headquarters at the Seneca Park Zoo. Look at these guys. I've never seen a lion before. These guys are way calmer than I thought, and the mannerisms between a house cat and a big cat like them has shocked me. The long blinks, the kind of sashes with the eyes and the head movement, they are very calm and they sleep a lot. So we're gonna get into hyperspectral sound. I'm here with Tom Schneider. He is the Director of Action Conservation. Did I get that right?
Close enough. Programming Conservation Action.
There we go. And how is the sound gonna, we'll talk about the lions first. How is the eclipse and how you guys are gonna monitor that sound? How is that gonna play out?
Well, you know, it's the first time we've done this, so we'll see. But basically what we're doing is we're putting these little audio recorders out at different habitats around the zoo, recording for a few days leading into it, and then day of, we're gonna record during totality and all of that. As you said, hyperspectrally, so we'll have the high frequency and low frequency record that, and then we're gonna analyze it and see what sounds we hear and put that up on our website.
And hyperspectral, is that essentially the sounds that you're not gonna be able to hear without a device?
Right, yeah, exactly. So bats are one that most people know. Bats are higher frequency, right? We don't hear those, but with these, we can actually record those and then slow that audio down and actually hear an audio representation of that or see it in the spectrogram, so what the image of the audio looks like.
And this is what you guys are gonna be using.
Yep.
What is this called?
It's called an Audio Moth, and it's an open source hardware, so, and it's available to anybody that wants to buy them. They're about $80 to $100. Open source hardware, open source software, so if you know how to make boards, you can actually make that yourself.
And how are you guys just going to plant these around and kind of pick up the sound, then pick them up the next day?
Yep, exactly. So after the event, we'll pick them up. It's all uncompressed audio, so they're very large files. So we have to do a little bit of manipulation to that to make them available to everybody to hear. But the idea is we publish that on our Eclipse page on the website, and everybody can go in and hear them if they want to. And then we'll do the research on that.
Yeah, getting into the research, is there something that you guys are looking for with this, something specific, or are we just going into a generalized view as to how this is going to affect them?
Yeah, I think with this technology being where it is now, this is just accessible to researchers more, right? So I think we're kind of in the infancy, really, of looking at what some of these animals, the sounds they make. You know, sometimes they're in that hyperspectral frequency that we don't hear. For instance, elephants are very low, you know, so they have a very low frequency that we don't hear, but it travels very far. So if the elephants make any of those sounds, these will pick them up and we'll be able to hear that.
Who's going to make the most noise out of all the animals?
The people that are here, probably, unfortunately.
We're not using these for the people, right?
No, not at all. It's every video I see, and they're all yelling and screaming, so hopefully it won't be that loud here, and we'll be able to pick up some of the animals.
And is there an animal that you are looking forward to researching?
No, really all of them. You know, that's why we're here, and why the animals are here, and why we're open to the public, so we can learn more about the animals and conserve them in their native range.
And you guys used these in Madagascar, I believe. What did you guys find when you did use them?
We're still analyzing that, but, you know, a lot more birds and insects and everything in those tropical jungles. So we'll make that available as soon as we analyze that as well. We're passing it through machine learning and AI right now to help us categorize all that audio.
And do you think that there's going to be a little bit of trickery when it comes to the animals so short of nighttime and then going into daytime, do you feel that they're going to be maybe discombobulated when this happens?
They'll definitely notice. I mean, we all notice, right? So it's interesting because those crepuscular hours, which are dusk and dawn, and the transition from day to night, that's when animals are the loudest, like right now, and the geese that you can hear in the background. So it's very short and very quick, so we'll see.
3-day weekend going down here at Seneca Park Zoo, Saturday, Sunday, into Monday. Come check it out. Look at the lions, man. A lot calmer than what I thought. They're gonna be putting these little bad boys about $80. I was told that it took about a year and a half to get their hands on one of these. A long wait, and they're ready to use them here at the Seneca Park Zoo. See who makes noises, see who doesn't. We'll see. Dan, Abby, back to you in studio.
I'm obsessed with the lions.
They're just sitting there enjoying themselves.
They're looking at you, Chris. Look at them.
Just
so
staring
cute.
You down.
They look a little sleepy, Chris.
Yeah.
Not morning people.
Or hungry.
Yeah, they could be hungry.
Or hungry.
Too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right, Chris, thanks so much.
Hey, coming up next, as Celtic Woman returns to the Auditorium Theater tonight, we meet the group's newest member.
We're back after this. With the once-in-a-lifetime solar eclipse just a few days away, it seems like everybody is getting ready for it with a lot of exciting activities in our area.
Yes, that's right. The Seneca Park Zoo is no exception. They're hosting a weekend of eclipse-themed events. That's where we find our Chris Lopez this morning. Where are we at, Chris?
We are right in front of the red panda right now, which is the original panda, not the pandas that you're used to, like Kung Fu Panda Bear. And they spend 13 hours a day either foraging or eating some of this stuff, and they still manage to stay slender. I also want to point out, look at the gradiency of the fur, how natural that is. They did not go to a stylist. That is incredible. I'm here with Beth LaPierre. She is director of marketing, and you guys have a huge weekend, a lot of stuff going on. And what do you guys have going on? Let's start out just with this weekend. What are some of the fun things people can look forward to?
Sure. First off, the weather's going to be beautiful, right? This rain's going to stop.
Hopefully, yes.
We have our nature cart's going to be out all weekend. That's where our naturalists, their zoo educators, they're going to be talking about all things eclipse, all things nocturnal animals, how animals are affected by the moon and the sun. They'll be doing pinhole cameras, which is a great way to view the eclipse at home. We'll be handing out our branded eclipse glasses, of course. We also will be doing some science, as Tom talked about in a previous segment, with audio moth and hyperspectral recording. And then we have animal programming. It's spring break, so we have our full summer preview. So we'll be doing animal meet and greets. We'll be doing keeper chats and animal experiences all day long.
And you guys have some special guests coming through to educate people. I believe someone from NASA is coming through.
Yes, we have Skylar Kleinschmidt. He's a heliophysicist from NASA. And we have Emily Rice, who's a former zoo teen, which we're super proud of. And she is an astrophysicist. So they'll be doing workshops several times a day. You can view the whole schedule at senecaparkzoo.org/eclipse.
And who is this geared towards? Is this geared towards families?
Anybody really that's interested in animals, viewing the eclipse and being in a fun location, right? You could view it at home, certainly, but if you want a full day packed with activities and lunch and all that, come to the zoo.
And life doesn't stop after the eclipse, contrary to popular belief. What do you guys have going on after that?
It's summer. First up is Birds, Bees, and Brews. That's going to be kind of like our Zoo Brew event. It's a tasting event. That's on May 10th. And then we, once it hits Memorial Day weekend, we're into our summer schedule.
And then, so I want to ask you, I haven't gotten a chance to really ask anyone any type of, what's your, like, favorite thing that's going to happen during this weekend here at the zoo?
I think the NASA expert that's coming in and talking about everything that NASA is going to be doing during the eclipse. He brings in, you know, world-class science. I also think the audio moth study we're doing with hyperspectral recording is going to be amazing, right? The biggest question I've gotten for the past 6 months is, what are the animals going to do during the eclipse? Honestly, we don't know, and that's why we're studying them.
And when did this planning go into effect? When did you start planning for this? I believe you said you knew about this a year ago.
More than a year. If you have watched anything about the clips, you know Deb Ross. She is
we
the
do,
hugest
yes.
fan of the eclipse. So she's brought all the culturals together, culturals being the strong, the RMSC. So we've been meeting regularly, talking about how we want to get people from outside the area here, in addition to our own base.
And when does this three-day extravaganza start?
Starts on Saturday, so it runs Saturday through Eclipse Day, the 8th.
Okay, awesome. And how can people get tickets?
SenecaParkZoo.org/tickets.
There you go. Should be a beautiful, beautiful time. Come check it out here, Seneca Park Zoo. The red panda, he's gone. Red panda left. But come check him out. A lot of research going down. Everything should be very fun and educational. I love that. Check it out here at the Seneca Park Zoo. Dan, Abby, back to you in studio.
Chris, I've got to tell you, everybody in the studio and in the control room is like, Dan's like the red panda. They eat for 12 hours a day. And look at him just eating all those vegetables.
You guys are so mean. Chris, when you said, oh, look, the red panda's gone, Abby says, yeah, because he had to get back in the studio.
Yes, exactly. Yes,
man.
Exactly.
I love it.
All right. I put up with. Thank you, Chris.
Chris, thank you.